died for charity.
New at 6, a push to get more Metro Atlantans tested for HIV. Overall, fewer than 40% of people in the United States have ever been tested. Channel 2 anchor and Wendy Corona with us now from our newsroom. So, Wendy, you talked with local leaders who told you this kind of attention needs to happen every day.
That's what they're saying, especially here in Atlanta, where the HIV infection rates are staggering. It's estimated 4 Georgia counties make up 10% of the national burden for HIV, which makes testing locally extremely important in the fight against the HIV epidemic.
It's 60 seconds. It's quick. You get your results back immediately, and you know your status.
Lorenzo Davis is an HIV testing counselor at Out of the Closet on Cheshire Bridge Road, where free testing happens 5 days a week, not just on National HIV Testing Day.
People have been coming in, lining up to get tested.
At least today, testing activity was up. Nationally, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says only about 40% of Americans have ever been tested. And in Gwinnett, Cobb, DeKalb, and Fulton counties, test rates are low.
Every day needs to be HIV testing day.
Dr. Sandra Elizabeth Ford is the district health director in DeKalb County, where the CDC just gave more than $1 million to create pilot programs to help stop the HIV epidemic, part of a federal initiative to cut new infections by 75% in the next 5 years.
Number one, getting people tested. But the second priority, I would think, from my perspective, is making sure folks who have been identified as being positive are in care.
Consistent care to reduce the transmission rate. Education remains the priority. Davis adds community engagement will be key.
By meeting the community where they're at, trying to get more community engagement, letting people know we're here and we're providing service.
And there are events for National HIV Testing Day happening tomorrow as well as on Saturday. DeKalb County is hosting one, and there is a Taste and Test with a Cause Saturday at Out of the Closet on Cheshire Bridge Road. We have posted the information for you on our website. You'll find it at WSBTV.com. For now, live in the newsroom, Wendy Corona, Channel 2 Action News.
Oh, wait, El Hayes. Oh, wait, El Hayes. Who?
I'm just a young boy trying to stay alive. I keep my head up, I keep my shoulders tight. I beat the quarter every day. I thank the Lord that someday I'll be alright. From time to time, I'm in and out. I give in my all, what's this all about? It's a new day, and no hesitate. I break it down, I hit the flow, and I do it like this. I'm tempted, I'm tempted. I'm standing in delusion, flawless confusion. I'm ripping it up and losing it. She murking it, she working it, she losing it on the dance floor. My body's saying yes, and my body's saying no. I'm quick to leave, I'm quick to see when I hit the flow. She got me mopping it, she got me crunking it, she got me losing it. Drop it out and pick it up slow. She got me mopping it, she got me crunking it, she got me losing it. Oh, oh. I'm tempted, I'm tempted. I'm standing in delusion, flawless confusion. I'm ripping it up and losing it.
She working out, she working out, she losing
it. I'm standing in delusion, flawless confusion. I'm ripping it up and losing it. She working it, she working it, she losing it on the dance floor. She working it, she working it, she losing it. Oh, oh.
Oh my God, we have an amazing show for you guys. So hopefully you guys are ready. Are you ready? Me too. All right. We're going to start the show first with a special performance by Raymond Good. Yes. Yes, Raymond Good. He's going to be doing a skit from his book called Through Their Eyes. And also, they're going to have a mind dance. This is going to be amazing. And I hope you guys enjoy it.
Blessings, blessings, blessings. How's everyone doing? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, first of all, I want to thank Lorenzo for putting together an outstanding production fashion show for this day. Let's give him a round of applause. And doing it in such an historic month, so I wrote something down really quick to honor this month. We must always remember that we are all bonded together on this planet. Your fight is our fight. Your war is our war. Your voice is our voice. We must stand together in solidarity, brethren with brethren, and bosom with bosom in order to implement real change within our minds and within our hearts. Happy Pride Month. So the skits that you're about to see is from my book, Through Their Eyes. Now, through their eyes, with every newspaper, news story, a story that I heard personally, I put myself in the victim's shoes and wrote their stories. The book has 45 short stories, and they all have critical thinking questions at the end of every story. So we're going to hear some oral interpretations from the book, okay? Bless you.
I hate my mother. I do. You know, when I was young, she would move us around all the time. Once I get to know someone, I'd have to get up and go. I went to 4 elementary schools, 2 middle schools, and 2 high schools. I mean, worst of all, she'd have a different guy over every week. Real dirtbags, too. The kind of guys that once they were tired of hitting on my mom, they'd start to hit on my little sister. I remember when I was 9, she brought home the meanest one of all, John. He'd come home drunk and just wail on my mom, bruise her every night. On my 9th birthday, he came home real drunk, and I heard him in my sister's room. Then I kind of heard some crying, and then it got muffled. And I thought something was going on. I don't know. So I just got up and I walked over to her room. And I saw John with his hand over her mouth rubbing her leg. And I guess I made a noise or something because he jumped off her, ran past me, pushed me down. And he said, I was just kissing her goodnight. My sister jumped off her bed and ran to me and hugged me. She was shaking. I mean, I didn't know what to do. I was 9. And then 2 nights later, the same thing happened. But this time I didn't get up. I just stayed in bed with the pillow over my head, just saying, he's just kissing her goodnight. He's just kissing her goodnight. And then I woke up the next morning and walked past my sister's room. And there was blood on her sheets. I didn't know how to react. I just brushed my teeth and went to school. And then when I came home, there was new sheets on her bed. My mom had changed the sheets while we were in school. For the next 3 days, same thing. Blood on the sheets, new sheets. Blood on the sheets, new sheets. My sister just completely shut down. She wouldn't talk to any of us. My mother one morning at breakfast said, "What's wrong?" Like she didn't know what was wrong. My sister didn't even look at her. And then, one night, John came into my room, smelling like beer. He leaned in real close to my ear and he said, "I just want to kiss you goodnight." And then he raped me that night. But I didn't make a sound. I didn't scream, I didn't cry, anything. I just laid there while he was kissing me. You know, because I figured if he was in my room, then he wasn't kissing my sister. And I deserved it. I mean, I let it happen to my sister, so why shouldn't it happen to me? Well, the next night, Mom kicked John out. I guess it's different when your son's getting all the attention. But you know, every boyfriend that my mother had after that, I just sort of started to expect it. I'd wear women's clothing, start flirting when they were around. I was raped by every one of my mom's boyfriends since I was 9 years old. But you know, I was just trying to protect my sister. Does that make me a bad person? just trying to protect my sister the best way I knew how.
My husband and I had both seen the signs when Torrance was a little boy. He used to play with his sister's dolls instead of the G.I. Joe toys that my husband bought for him. My husband thought getting him involved in sports, that would break him out of the habit. Torrance performed very poorly in sports. My husband thought if he was around other boys, it would toughen him up. But I could see in his eyes that he hated playing football. He tried so hard to impress us. But when I looked at him, I knew something was different about my little boy. When he was 15, we sent him to a church that said they could cure him of his sexual tendencies. They treated homosexuality like it was a disease. My baby would write to me every day and tell me how much he hated being there. He felt like he was being punished for something he had no control over. As his mom, I was torn. I felt like we were punishing him for something he didn't even do. I remember walking in his room one day, catching him masturbating to gay porn magazines. I couldn't even bring myself to tell my husband, because that would have crushed him if he had known, because he tried so hard to make him into a man. He kept telling me, it's a phase. He'll grow out of it. But after that day, I knew my baby was special. And it was my job as his mommy to love him unconditionally. Torrance shied away from all his high school dances. Like, we even had to convince him to go to his senior prom. He ended up taking a girl from his school, and my husband said, see, I was just a phase. The next day, I saw him crying in his room. When we talked, he told me he was gay. That he had sex with the girl after prom, but he felt so dirty afterwards. After prom night, though, my husband never spoke of the gay thing again. He thought prom night was some big turning point in Torrance's life. When my son received a full scholarship to Morehouse College for engineering, my husband adapted the thought, out of sight, out of mind. When Torrance came home, me, life was good. It was better than it had been in a long time. We laughed, we talked. Then he came home in the middle of his sophomore year, and he said, I'm not going back to school. He shut himself up in his room, and he refused to talk to anyone. We tried to talk to him, but he just lay on the bed in silence. And it was like he completely shut himself out from the world. He stopped eating. He stopped talking. He stopped living. And then one night he came down for dinner. And by this time, he was spending all his time in his room, so we knew he had something he needed to say. He sat at the dining room table for such a long time. And he finally said, I have AIDS. I started crying immediately. So that was all he said before he got up and walked away from the table. My husband called him back, and I will never forget the words he said. He said, I love you, son. We love you. And that will always remain. You're our son. We can work through anything. We're a family, and we're going to get through this as a family. So my husband had us grab hands, and we prayed all night. After that night, things began to get better. We had rough times like any other family, but, you know, we pulled through. Torrance found the strength to go back to college. He was determined to complete school because graduating was important to him. Graduating was one of the things that he wanted to accomplish. It meant the world to him, and it meant the world to us. My son lived life to the fullest and graduated with top honors from Morehouse College. He moved on to become the top engineer at his job, and he lived every day like it was his last. The day he died took a large piece from all of us. My son was gay. My son had AIDS. I am so, so proud of him. He was my son. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Lorenzo Davis. I actually created the whole Taste and Test for the Cause. As you can see, it's been really hectic here. We got a great, amazing fashion show. Going to be actually ripping the ribbon, pretty much walking the runway.
My name is Courtney Daniel Robinson, and I'm originally from Spartanburg, South Carolina. Then I moved to Charlotte, North Carolina. Now I'm in Atlanta.
Denzel Dorsey, the name of my company is Chosen Entity. I'm originally from Birmingham, Alabama. I moved here to Atlanta, Georgia.
This is a huge, huge cause that I know that the community needs more information about. And what would be a better way to show people why this is so important by actually having a fashion show to engage people, to see that we can also be very, very unique in the ways that we promote and educate.
And fashion gives them that outlet. You know, fashion actually draws the attention your way. Sometimes negative, sometimes positive, but the thing is, you know, who you are, you present to the world. As far as personality, and your personality often shows up in your fashion and the way that you dress. And I think that liberates and sets a lot of people free in so many ways. And it brings about confidence. It brings about strength. It brings about freedom. It brings about change.
Hey, this is the DJ right here. How are you?
Represent Hood Rich Radio.
Yes.
DJ B Black.
This time we gon' do for the win. I remember nights, long, long nights. I would say, baby, I love you. You reply, go right. So I wrote this verse in your honor. Excuse me, your honor, for her. I died 3 times, but I promise, cause that's real rap. And this is real facts. So back to the subject. Girl, you know I love you. Real talk, I just wanna hug you. Hit my left and my right. Got me so tight, feeling like Ali fighting Frazier in the knife. Even when I'm feeling like when Katrina hit the knife in the night, you told me, fall back, it's alright. Well, okay, I laced up my all whites. You told me go and get it, so I've been moving like a sinner. Had to turn my jets on, cause my team swag silly. Had to get a couple meals, cause we got a couple bills. I'ma fall back, do you? We gon' blow and chill. So let's do it again. When I write with the pen, all rights begin. Press hard like I'm inscripting on you boys. Never mention a name, cause we both feel the same. So I go hard in the trenches. God is my witness. Young boy, speed it up, pay attention. Yep, this what she told me to do. No Weezy, best southern rapper from the south, so easy. West Coast chick who fell in love with the B.I.G. Easy, West Coast chiefin' like Casey for no reason. True words what I'm speaking, control the game, no leaking. Real rap ain't and change twice, 3 my favorite number, so I'm rolling 3 dice, all black and white. I'm slick with the wordplay, I might be. I don't need J.R. Blue Tree if I got.
It's easy to just educate someone with a book or just tell you facts about something. But people will really pay attention when they actually can see a visualization and also something that they can like know why this is huge to know about, so that they can get tested and to just move them to educate somebody else about it too. So I knew that's really, really the reason why I wanted to be a part of this.
It's important to get tested for HIV because the HIV rates are so high, guys. It's National HIV Testing Day. Make sure you get tested.
Everybody needs to come out and get tested. It's very quick, it's very simple, and you always need to get tested.
I think it's a good way to get people to acknowledge the importance of HIV testing. You can come, get some nice food, you can even shop in the store, and it's a really fun thing.
Free HIV testing in the store!
Our next performance we have is going to be from Courtney, from Suits.me, along with Levi Music.
And
Ray Johnson.
Ray Johnson.
And Ray Johnson.
And Ray Johnson as your performer. Hit it!
That's so much for Mikey.
I'm looking in the mirror at this woman down and out. She's internally dying. I know this is not what love's about. I wanna be this woman the second time around. Cause I'm waking up screaming, no longer believing that I'm gonna be around. And over that I try. And over that you lie.
So let me go on over get this straight, because I ain't trying to get sued by nobody's social media or Tyler Perry. My name is Imara Bird.
Oh.
I'm from Alabama, hon. I ain't from Louisiana, wherever the hell she from, but it's all right. I don't apologize for cousins, because I know some kids there, but it's all right, y'all. Y'all folks cut you out all the time. It's okay.
Hello.
But y'all having a good time so far?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm burning the hell up. Y'all me too.
The one thing that inspires me about fashion, I think, is freedom. For me, it liberated me from a lot of the stereotypes and the statistics of what they feel like should be masculine or feminine, or what you should look like, what you should dress like, how you should appear.
My mom is my inspiration, because she's very simplistic, but she also brings a pop to her wardrobe, which brings it all together. Not doing too much, but still bringing something that brings her own to it. So that's always inspired me when I, you know, create and when I actually put on my own pieces too.
yourself outwardly, what you're trying to say inwardly. Because some people, you know, they can't express themselves. They don't know how to say what they're trying to say, how to connect with people, how to, you know, go around and, you know, just show who they are.
Hey,
hey,
hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey, hey,
who's screaming to actually step out until they actually see one person that's actually bold enough to step out and be different.
It's T3, baby.
Just worry about you and me. Please don't let go of me and me.
that I actually pride myself on is that it's different. It goes against the grain instead of with the grain. You know, when you paint, they tell you to go with the grain, but I go against it. I don't like to fit in. I like to be different. You know, I'm in it, but not of it, if that makes sense. And that's just who I am as a designer. You know, I promote confidence. I promote a person to be who they are and to be the very best version of themselves that they can actually be in this. Presenting that through fashion and what you wear is that way to do it. By all means, I say go for it. Go big or go home like they always do.
You go.
We gon' fly high wherever we
wherever
go.
We go.
It's us against the world, so let's go.
Live it up,
live it up.
Let's go.
Live it up,
live it up.
Let's go.
Live it up,
live it up.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Live it up, but yeah.
It's put your hand in my hand, and I'ma take it from here. Baby, here's the plan, and we gon' hop in the whip, go have a sip, spend some cash, and have a blast. Let's paint the town red. Live it up, living life to the fullest. Fingers up, not giving a care what they say about us. We got one life to live, let's just do right. We gon' LOVE ITUP until the sun come up. Put that on repeat because life too short, ain't got no time to waste. Let's relax and chill, time to get away. We get some chill around off every day. Not worry about nothing, cast our cares away. In the middle of the ocean, floating away. Sipping champagne with a special OJ.
We gon' live it up, up, up.
Put your hand in my hand, that's G-O.
That's G-O.
I promise to never, ever let you go.
We gon' fly high, wherever we go.
Go.
We go.
It's us against the world, so let's go.
Live it up,
live it up.
Let's go.
Live it up,
live it up.
Let's go.
Live it up,
live it up.
Let's go.
Live it up,
go.
Live it up, but yeah.
With yours and mine, the chemistry is amazing. It blows my mind. It took a moment of trust for us to level up. In a world of ours, only us. All smiles, baby. All smiles, baby. I got what you need. Trust and believe. I got us from here. No need to worry. All white, everything. Partaking the beauty that the life brings. Enjoy the good life, just like we should. No matter up or down, we gon' ride. We good. We gon' look.
So the reason why I put on this event,
quiet on
the
set,
is to get everybody to come for a reason to get tested, more people getting involved, because it starts with us first, everybody. If we don't do the work, if we don't put the work in, okay, nothing will get done. So at the end of the day, please get tested, know your status. I hope y'all enjoy the rest of the food over there. Thank you for the support. I appreciate everybody. Let's give a round of applause for the advertising staff right now. Our volunteers. Woo! Yeah. Also, our store manager, Misha. Yeah. Also, a round of applause for our great pharmacy over here. Woo! And also, let's give a round of applause for the PhDs who's doing the HIV testing at this moment.
Okay.
This next year, it's getting bigger and bigger. This is our third year actually doing the tasting test with the cost. We're gonna have more restaurants, more people get involved, and it's getting too big to the point we can't even do it here anymore. Wow. That's how much we've grown as overall this whole event coming together, getting the community more involved. So let's give a round of applause.
She got me wanting it. She got me losing it. Oh, oh, I'm tempted, I'm tempted, I'm standing in delusion. Flawless confusion, I'm ripping it up, been losing it.
She working out, she working out, she losing
it. I'm tempted, I'm tempted, I'm standing in delusion. Fall.
all this confusion. I'm ripping it up, been losing it. She working it, she working it, she losing it on the dance floor. She working it, she working it, she losing it, oh, oh.
My friend helped me to realize some things about me that I didn't know or realize until now. Since elementary school, I have been picked on, ostracized, chased, and whatever else happens to the uncool kids. Because of my size, I was called fat or roly-poly. The cool kids used to spit on the back of my coat. I was always the center of the joke, such as, what's the capital of Thailand? Bangkok. Then the cool kids would punch me in the... I had very low self-esteem and did not have a girlfriend until I was 17 years old and in the 12th grade. Simply put, I was a virgin and did not experience my first kiss until the 12th grade. Everyone in school knew me, but I had very, very few friends. My friend pointed out to me that I was not judgmental and I had no problem talking to anyone. She says she finally understood why I'm this way because I used to be on the other side of the fence. I know what it feels like to be at the bottom of the barrel. I felt the ugliness of people's harsh words and was the butt of their jokes. I, in turn, know what it means to have self-hatred because that was what was developed. Enough people said things about me that I started to believe what they were saying. I spent enough mental hours in shame and self-pity that I developed a tough shell towards the world. Within this shell lies a scared little boy full of mixed emotions. Inside this shell is still a boy lost in fantasy world and finding out who he is. The problem with the shell is sometimes the guard is let down and the outside world penetrates my wonderland. It hurts to let that shell down and people turn out to not be who they say they are. I understand what you are going through and I continually say, be yourself. Don't let the world beat you down so bad that you don't know how to bounce back. I would be the first to tell you that you are weird, but that simply means that you are unique. I am still weird and different, but I embrace my weirdness. I have taken the best shot that the world has to offer and stood tall against it all. If I have the courage, then so do you. Look inside yourself and listen to that little voice that's telling you to better yourself. Follow your instincts and not the crowd. Have a tough shell towards the world, but continue to live in your wonderland. Don't be afraid to let your guard down, but choose when to let your guard down. Letting it down does not make you weak. It only means that you are still human. Blessings.
Head is bitter, I can't cut.